Hi, welcome to the software testing course from Delft University of Technology. In this course, we're going to teach you how to test the software and make sure it works, and how to, as much as possible, automate every step that we can. By testing software, I mean that we are going to explore different techniques to design test cases, for example, based on the requirements, based on the source code, analyze boundaries, and etc. And by automation, I mean making sure that a machine can do the tasks that humans would just take too much time to do or wouldn't be as good as a machine. And you're going to see throughout the course that software testing is a very creative activity. And while creativity is fundamental, we are going to study systematic and rigorous ways to derive test cases. In addition, this course will be very practical, meaning whenever we discuss some technique, we are going to apply this technique in several code examples. So you should expect to see a lot of Java code throughout this course. And we hope that you can then generalize everything you learn here to then test the software that you work in your real life. So why should we think about software testing? Why should we actually care about software testing? Well, because bugs are everywhere. And you, as a human being, you probably faced a few bugs in your life. Some of them probably didn't affect you that much. But definitely some other bugs really affected your life, and you wanted them to never happen. So just to give an impression of how easy doing mistakes is, let's start with a requirement. Let's suppose we have this customer, and this person wants a software that, given a list of numbers, the software should return the smallest and the largest number in this list. This looks like a very simple program to do. So let's get our hands dirty and do a small implementation in Java. So in Java, what I would do is I would come up with a class. I'm going to call it numFinder. Then I would create this find method that receives an array of integers. And the first thing I would do is to then go through all the elements of this list and store the smallest number in a variable and the largest number in another variable. If n is smaller than the smallest number we have seen, then we just replace it. And we do the same for the largest. If n is bigger than the largest, we just replace largest to n. We need to initialize, of course, the smallest and the largest fields. And let's then do this in a smart way. Let's make the smallest to be equal to the largest integer possible. And in this way, any first number in the n variable will always be smaller and thus replaced. And the other way around for the largest. Any first number in the n variable will replace the number in the largest field. Then we just add some getters for these fields. That's the way we do in Java. And that's it. We are done with the implementation. And ourselves as developers, that's what we often do. We implement the requirements, and we do small checks to make sure it works. One way to do a small check would be to come up with a main method that tries the program a bit. As an example, let's see what happens if we execute our program with some random numbers as inputs, like 4, 25, 7, and 9. To see if the program behaves correctly, let's just print the largest and the smallest fields. That's also quite common, right? We just print things on the screen, and we check them manually. But if I run the program, that's the output that I have, 25 and 4. This means our software works. We can ship it to our customers. Can we? Well, as soon as we ship the code we wrote, we will have a problem, because the software doesn't work for all possible cases. There's a bug. And I'm going to show you the source code again right now. Pause this video and see if you can find the bug. Did you? If you pass, for example, an input that is 4, 3, 2, and 1, so numbers in a decreased order, this is the output you get. The largest number is equals to minus and a very large number, which is the integer.mean value, the constant that we used before. So our program didn't behave as expected, right? We have a bug. But before anything, let's just fix it. If we go back to the source code, we can see that this bug is actually caused by the else if. Take a moment here to understand why. The else if should actually be just an if. Yes, this is a very simple bug, but the point is that those mistakes can and do happen all the time. Ourselves as developers, we usually deal with very complex software, and it is pretty hard for us to have everything in our minds. And this is why we need to test software, because bugs do happen. And they can really have a huge impact in your lives. And that's what we're going to focus throughout this course. Hopefully, with everything we're going to teach you, you will have enough knowledge to rigorously test your software and make sure that bugs don't happen. I hope this video serves as a good motivation for you to study software testing. I'll see you in the next video.